In the not too distant future, next Sunday AD, there was a guy named Joel, not too different from you or me. He worked at his Monic Institute, just another face in a red jumpsuit. He did a good job cleaning up the place, but his bosses didn't like him, so they shot him into space. We'll send the cheesy movies, the worst we can find. He'll have to sit and watch them all, then the monitor is mine. Now keep in mind, Joel can't control where the movies begin or end, because he used those special parts to make his robot friends.
Robot, we'll call Cabot. Gypsy,
hi girl.
Tom Servo,
Croak. If you're wondering how he eats and breathes and other science facts, then repeat to yourself, it's just the show. I should really just relax. For Mystery Science Theater 3000.
They promised me students, but all I got were monkeys. Monkeys, monkeys! So I took off my wetsuit, dropped that hedge clipper, and walked out of that zoo forever.
Well, you've created quite a little world for yourself, Larry.
Hey, tell me about when you went mad now.
Well, it was the ice capades, and I was pop riveting my kneecaps to Peggy Fleming's Zamboni. Or maybe it was 56, Sun Valley. I was found behind the soft serve machine, drooling over a picture of Dick Buttons. Or perhaps Oslo, when I was found drunk and woozy, scratching the name Toller Cranston into my upper thigh with a nail. You see what
I
done?
Is that when you went mad?
No, that's when I became a scientist.
Oh, speaking of scientists, time to call Joel. We have to start the experiment. The movie's great this week.
Oh, yes, yes. Come in, Joel, you fancy pansy Nancy boy.
Hey, sirs, I'm ready for this week's invention exchange. Bring it in a little bit, Cambot. This is a special purse I developed for women who are sick and tired of the constant threat of getting their purse snatched. See how it looks like an ordinary handbag? When street thugs open it, voila! Hell in a handbag.
Nice use of pain, Joelmeister. Now here's ours. As you know, toy manufacturers are always making their toys too safe. And what children want is realism.
And danger! That's why we created the acetylene-powered thunder lizard.
Yes, it's a role-playing game, and it comes complete with these costume glasses.
Just set up your field of play, then reach out and torch someone.
Oh,
look at him go! Oh, it's gotta hurt.
Wow, that's really sick and twisted.
Thank you.
Now here's something that'll really rub you wrong.
Yes, it's one of our favorites. It's called Mad Monster.
Oh, it's got a neat little laboratory tucked behind a bookcase and a couch you can strap victims to.
Yes, and the screen is alive with crepe hair and spirit gum.
Oh, and we have the second installment of Rocket Men on the Moon. Oh,
yes. Yuck. This one is called the Molten Terror.
Oh, movie side!
I know I gotta get wheels for you sometime.
Those scientists are really dorks. It's Pumpkin Boy again. Radar men from the moon.
Hey, it stars the same people as last week.
Oh, it's just featuring the same people as last week.
Featuring, sorry.
These are the extras. They'll probably get killed.
Dale Van Sickle never made a bad film.
He never made a real film.
Consolidated Film Industries.
Franklin and John. Oh.
You can only dream. Chapter 2, Molten Terror! Ooh, isn't Terra bad enough without being molten? Mando Moody fights the Moon Men in an effort to escape Radek, who plans to disintegrate him with a ray pistol.
Well, then they're gonna work things out.
Hey, Joel, didn't we see this last time?
Yeah, they're just recapping what happened.
Well, he blew up the same. Cody continued to fight with those sock men. Willard Scott then reloaded his cheese pistol.
Isn't that Marty Feldman? Guns by Vidal Sassoon. This is where we came in, you guys.
Oh, if they would have shown him diving out of the way last time, I wouldn't have spent the week worrying about him.
Nice punch.
He walked right into it.
Ooh.
Lobby, first floor, tobacconist, newspapers.
I'm outside. Let's see, I stand in this corner, little tweak of the nipples, and I'm out of here.
Oh, oh no, oh.
Amazing.
You'll believe a man can fly. Meanwhile, back at Mesa Verde. That's gotta be hard on the arches. I don't care where you're from.
Oh, I think those fell a long time ago.
I'll be in my trailer. Hope there's some deli food left. And no brown M&Ms this time.
Oh, how rude.
So Riddick plans to invade the Earth with his army from the moon. As soon as the saboteurs he already has there finish softening up our defenses. Do you think you'll be able to do it? I'm afraid he might. I don't know how many men or rocket ships he has, but his atomic weapons are so far ahead of anything we have, he wouldn't need a very big army. What did you find out about the ray guns?
Ron and Nancy?
There's an element called lunarium instead of uranium as the base for their atomic reactions.
And they take an hour to load.
They can control the reaction so they will work either as a disintegrating ray or as an explosion like our atomic bomb.
Well, if their weapons are that powerful, it would be impossible for our people to attack them here.
Stop whining.
Even if we had rockets enough to transport.
He's got a real hairy name.
That's right. Apparently, they let us land because they weren't afraid of a single ship, but they would undoubtedly blast down an invading fleet.
Then hadn't we better go back right away and warn our people?
Our orders were to find out if the attacks were coming from here, and if so, to try to figure out some way to stop them.
Those are large orders. All we have is a light machine gun and some hand grenades. They wouldn't do much to that walled city.
No. But there was one of their ray guns in Reddick's laboratory. If I could get hold of that, it would be easy to blast open their pressurized buildings and really put them out of business.
Then we'll have a sale.
Get the gun.
That may not be too tough. We brought some nitrous oxide with us, didn't we?
Yes, there's a small tank of it.
Why did we bring that anyway?
Who's going to be first?
They got it from Dennis Hopper, I think.
I'll find the air intake that leads to Reddick's laboratory and turn the gas into it. That ought to put them to sleep long enough to let me get away with the ray gun.
If it's like the gun you found on Earth, it'll be too heavy to carry, let alone fly with.
That's right. But the tripod isn't important. I'll dismantle a gun from the tripod. I think I can handle a gun all right.
It's feeling pretty good.
It'll be quite a load. I better get a helmet and go with you. Hank and Joan can stay here and guard the ship.
Okay. I may need some help at that.
Dibs on the rocket pack. I got it. No, my turn. Oh, shoot.
Oh, so they're both walking now.
They're walking on the moon.
You better not come any closer. I'll fly on in and get the gun. I'll manage to lug it back this far myself.
With the whole town. Good thing they move so we know who's talking.
Get around outside very well.
How come they got Groucho Marx mustaches on their helmets?
Nipple tweak, and I'm off. This is getting easy.
I love it when he does that. It's so cool.
He's gonna fly right into the commercial, I think.
Hey, Diana Ross is playing at Caesar's Palace.
And speaking of Diana Ross.
It looks just like the roof of my old grade school.
Let's see, just took up that nitrous oxide to the air intake shaft. Then we can do some serious dental work in there.
What's he gonna do anyway? Take out their fillings and serve them really cold drinks?
Maybe it's really healing them and they'll sound like the Munchkins.
Let's see, what's a four-letter word that means lunar? Planet? No, too many letters.
There he goes!
Woozy. No, that doesn't fit either.
Hookah. Hookah.
Something's wrong with the ventilating system. Get the oxygen.
No, it's my nap time.
It's not that hard of a job. Man, they're really overacting in this thing.
Nice swoon.
It's not that heavy. Well, you think in the future on the moon they'd at least get rid of the creaks.
Yeah.
Faker, Faker, you're dead.
Hey, either you guys got a 9/16 wrench? I'll just use this church key here.
Smell my fingers.
You're breathing for two now.
Buddy breathing.
That's better, man.
Oh, great. Hit him in the face and hurt your hand, dumbo.
Just give him a headbutt. Give him a headbutt. He's just wearing spandex on his head.
That's for Brian Gumble. That's for Gene Shalit. And that's for dressing up like Carmen Miranda. God, that was dumb.
Those are all Bob Mackie creations, aren't they? Someone's gonna snag their jammies on something sharp, I can tell. Earth chair, earth chair.
Hairlip, hairlip.
Bet they bust a vase.
I've never seen so many lava lamps in my life.
Hope he remembers what level he parked on. I'm in the Moon Man lot.
Maybe they won't notice me carrying this. I act really nonchalant.
Guards! Guards! The Earthman has escaped with a ray gun. Send a car out to search for him.
And don't forget the cheese. It's a moon car, and it's filled with evil Michelin men.
What a goofy-looking vehicle.
They better hurry. They gotta get that car back to the amusement park. That's an e-ticket ride, you know.
Yeah, but the chair is heavy. Is anybody after you? Not yet. Give me a hand with this. We've got to move fast.
Is it just me, or do those guys look like the crash dummies?
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle up.
By the guards at the canyon bridge.
No, and he won't move very fast carrying that gun.
Those fins really keep it stable.
I didn't know they had plywood on the moon.
There they are. Give them
a sprinkle paint either.
Hey, that thing's really gonna come in handy when Alan Shepard gets to the moon. It's gonna make a swell golf cart.
Let's try to keep going. Maybe we could dodge around those rocks and lose them.
Maybe you could use the gun. You know the big one that blows up things? Like moon cars, perhaps?
Wonder if they know how stupid they look right now.
They're still after us.
Give them the Hershey's head kiss of death.
Kind of looks like an electric razor.
Even our name says Merry Christmas.
That looks like a cave.
good. It's a moon mirage. Dolt. It died.
Those old two cycles, you know.
We can't follow them in there. Set the ray gun at constant heat.
Oh, no, constant heat. I love her films.
Right. You know, that constant heat ray sounds a lot like a Chevy horn.
This must be the molten terror of the title.
They're turning that mountain into taffy.
I think they may turn our heroes into taffy soon.
It's a big rock candy mountain.
Snack Canyon.
What's that?
It's the land of Dairy Queen, and a river of chocolate's coming right for you.
Never mind the gun.
Isn't that lava? Well, I guess they'll be cooked, but their hands will be clean. Pumice action.
What would you do now, Crow?
I'd panic.
Panic? Tom?
Oh, same. No question.
It's got to be a way out. Here it comes.
Well, this must be what it's like to be in the stomach of someone drinking a malt. What do you think?
This is cold.
Blow on it.
I think we got to get out of here, you guys.
Yes.
What a sticky mess.
It's almost time to go.
You coming?
Looks like the floor of a movie theater. Yes. I've got to be a macho. Hey, excuse me, miss. Hey, I've never noticed you on the ship before. I'm Tom Servo, man about satellite. You know, I know I look small and all, but I'm really built like a Cuisinart, at least that's what they tell me. You know, you're kind of quiet. I like that in a woman, really. You know, too many of the gals I know just like to rub exotic oils on me and fan me, you know. It's okay, if you know what I mean. Well, maybe you don't. I don't know. I need a change, though. I need a woman more my speed, and I noticed you have 11 of them. Oh. Did I offend you? I'm sorry. I see you're blushing. No, that's tomato juice. I love a woman with juice in their head. It's really a turn-on to me, my little scientific calculator. Ever gotten a wild hair and just filled your head with guacamole just for the hell of it? I'm the kind of robot who likes to throw caution to the wind, if you know what I mean. And if you do, please tell me. Hey, I see you've still got a power cord. I like a woman with a healthy power source. I really do. You know, I'm coming out a bit strong, I know, and I'm sorry, but I love your lines. God, you've got classic features. Crush, great, chop, whip. Baby, you've got it all. What? Oh, and a lovely singing voice, too. Oh, you do have it all. Joel, I'm in love. Joel. That's it. The gauntlet's been thrown. Nobody drinks from my gal.
What are you talking about, Tom?
My gal. I'm in love, and you're drinking from her. Let's
Tom,
go.
Tom, it's go. A blender. It's a blender.
Blender. I knew that. I've got to be. Excuse me, miss. I've noticed you. Oh, excuse me, Mr. Coffee. Okay.
There you go.
Okay.
Gotta look at them at an angle when they're like, oh, this is the LV. Yeah, that's better.
They're so hard to read.
That's bright.
They should have gotten the guy out of the light before they shot this.
It's the cameraman.
Should be at more of an angle or a crow.
Switch. Yeah.
That helps.
No, it's the same. Now straight, okay.
kitty.
They must have some sort of leash law there. Oh, they do. Pretty extreme.
Oh, he's got a thorn in his paw.
No, I don't think that's a thorn. I think it's a IV. Yeah.
Oh, he's giving plasma. Must be down on his luck, poor dog.
Acme Coyote Transfuser.
Now for the thorough examination. Just relax.
Hey, it's Bill Bixby as Lou Ferrigno.
Yes, I know you'd like to join your fellows outside and howl at the moon. But you're serving a much better purpose. Yes, you're serving science through me.
Penny's making union scale.
Oh, he'll soon have him housebroken. And it will be painful.
I could have had a V8.
You know, he's very protective about the secret recipe of his sun tea.
It's a bit of the hair of the dog. How does that go, Joel?
Hair of the dog that bit you.
Yeah.
Let's see, 3 parts gin, 1 part vermouth.
I like mine very dry.
Hair designs by Shemp Howard. He's got an itch.
Are you quite comfortable, patient?
Sure, doctor.
Just because his circulation's cut off at his chest, hands, and waist.
Reason to be afraid.
Yeah, that's right, patient. There's nothing to be afraid of. Nothing at all.
This is going to hurt the dog a lot more than it's going to hurt me.
Kind of dopey.
Rock-a-bye monster on the little bed.
When you wake up, some townsfolk will be dead. Changing.
Looks kind of like Fred Travellina now.
Kind of. He's growing hair. My God, he's turned him into Abe Lincoln.
The rail splitter.
Wow. Isaac Asimov.
Lecherous scientist.
Amish farmer. Quaker Oats man.
Dr. Cornelius from Planet of the Apes.
A cure for baldness at last. I'm calling it Helsinki formula.
Line.
Line.
Line, please.
Gentlemen, I wish you were here to see the proof of my claim that the transfusion of blood between different species is possible. A few moments ago, Pedro was a man. A harmless, good-natured man.
Now Bingo is his name-o.
He looks just like one of the flying monkeys from The Wizard of Oz.
Now he's his own best friend.
He's no longer human. He's a wolf. Snarling, ferocious, lusting for the kill.
He needs to go outside, too, I think.
A scientific miracle, gentlemen.
Hey, it's William S. Burroughs.
You're a madman, Cameron. Your claim is ridiculous.
exactly what you said in the newspaper, Professor Blaine. That I was a madman.
I may be mad, but you're transparent.
By a science chair at the university. Perhaps you'll change your mind one day, soon. When Petro tears at your throat.
Poppycock.
Want to. But look.
I don't think they should let him get on the furniture. He's getting all tangled up.
Even now, he'd like to be at his work.
Ripping out throats.
The agent has brought about a complete transition from man to wolf.
Your crazy experiments are a disgrace to science.
Mr. Mooney.
Gail Gordon.
Those are the very words you used in denouncing me to the faculty. Professor Fitzgerald. Science. What do you know about science? You with your hidebound dogmas and shriveled mind that refuses to recognize progress.
Hey, it's Colonel Potter.
What did progress
Harry Morgan.
Do with your foolish tampering with nature?
I'm glad you asked that question, Professor Hatfield. You also were one of those stupid fools who raised their voices against me.
I feel like he's talking to us.
You're aware, of course, that this country is
I got a question.
Our armed forces are locked in combat with a savage horde who fight with fanatical fury.
Don't think he heard you.
Well, that fanatical fury will avail them nothing when I place my new serum at the disposal of the War Department. Just picture, gentlemen, an army of wolfmen, fearless, raging.
Shedding.
Every man a snarling animal.
My and an army of people behind him with pooper scoopers.
Millions of such animal men. Men who are governed by one collective thought, the animal lust to kill without regard to personal safety.
Republicans?
Such an army will be invincible, gentlemen. Such an army will sweep everything before it.
Your scheme is too utterly fantastic, Dr. Cameron.
You're fools, all of you. Poor, blind fools, especially you, Dr. Warwick.
Poor, blind fools.
How would you control these wolfmen? I perfected an antidote that induces the return of immediate normalcy.
And I suppose that it would be an easy matter to round up a million wild animals and administer an antidote. No, Cameron, you're mad. Stark, raving mad. And I, for one, am in favor of...
Silence!
I have a whistle.
I'm not interested in your imbecilic mouthings. All of you demonstrated your lack of vision by demanding my resignation from the faculty.
And your lack of bodies.
Well, you accomplished your purpose. You cast me out. You robbed me of everything that I held most dear in life. Position, honor, respect.
My own parking spot.
You branded me as a madman. Held me up to ridicule before the whole world. But now it's time for my revenge. Pedro will see to that.
Sorry we said anything.
There's no escape for any of you. You shall die one by one at the hands of the scientific marvel that you scoffed at.
What a grouch.
Intimidate us with fantastic threats. You're a faker, Cameron, a mad faker. We'll have you ostracized by every scientist in the country.
There are institutions for madmen.
Like the Pentagon.
We'll see that you're confined in one.
You would think, since it was his imagination, he'd at least have them be afraid of him.
They left. He should have served drinks. Canapes, those little sandwiches with the crust cut off. Nut cups.
Next comes the ghost of Christmas present.
Christmas present for me?
Okay, boy, okay. I'll get you a liver snap.
I hope he puts it on his nose.
What's the matter, boy? Skippy.
I think Skippy is what he was eating. Look, I revolutionized shaving forever.
Hey, he looks okay. Or as okay as he ever will.
I bet his breath is terrible, though.
But his mouth is cleaner than yours or mine. That's 7 hours to you and me.
Feel dog tired.
Terrible headache. And I had some kind of an awful dream. I was running all over the countryside chasing people. trying to kill him. What does a dream like that mean, Doctor?
Oh, that doesn't mean anything. You just had a nightmare, that's all.
But why should I be trying to kill people? Even in my dreams, I ain't got nothing against nobody.
Well, let's not talk about it anymore. Go to bed. Our work's done for tonight.
I set up some newspapers in the corner for you.
Tell me about the rabbits again, George. And these are doors, Pedro.
Coming down to find out how much longer you're going to work. Do you realize how late it is?
No, I didn't. I was absorbed in my work.
Oh, we did a lot of work tonight, and I slept almost an hour, and I had the awfulest dream.
Go to bed, Peter.
Yes, sir, Doctor. Good night, Miss Lenore.
Good night, Patron.
I'll be lurking for you.
Ted, what kind of experiments are you doing that you need Pedro?
Oh, he just helps me in the laboratory, moving the heavy things around. He's a very strong man, is Pedro.
How much longer are we going to be here, then?
Why?
Because the place gets on my nerves. I hate it.
Your hating it has nothing to do with being separated from that young reporter friend of yours, has it?
It has. And I want to know when we're going back to the city.
Very soon now, dear. My work's practically finished.
What was that?
It was Pedro talking to sleep again.
Well, that noise. It sounded like a wild animal howling. And I heard the same thing last night.
Oh, that's probably some dog in the neighborhood. Dogs do howl, perhaps. You mustn't let things like that upset you. Now, come along here, even aside.
She wants to be Judy Garland in the worst way, doesn't she?
I think so.
That is sound, right?
Hey, it looks just like the front of the Munster's house.
Without the charm.
Good morning, Miss Lenora. I was hoping you'd come to the garden this morning. I got something for you.
It's a human head.
Oh, they're lovely. Thank you.
I'll pick them for you every day if you like them.
Well, that's very kind of you.
I want you to meet my brother, Fred Gwynn.
What's the matter, Miss Lenora?
Pedro, I don't like this place.
No, I guess you feel about this place the same as I do. I'm afeard of it. Especially at night when the mist comes up out of the swamp. Of course, it's all right when the sun's shining like it is this morning.
Are there any wild animals around here?
Just you,
oh,
Furball.
Yes, there's lots of them. How come you ask?
Oh, I was just curious. Say, Pedro, what do you do when you work with Dad in the laboratory?
Oh, I sit, I roll over, and I shake sometimes.
I don't rightly know. Besides, I ain't supposed to tell nothing. Your pop made me promise.
Oh, you can trust me. I wouldn't tell anybody.
Well, we...
Jeez, it's Alan Brady.
No, I ain't saying nothing.
Pedro, did you fetch the paper this morning?
Good morning, Dad.
You sleep well?
Yes, very well. Well, look at the flowers that Pedro gathered for me.
Very pretty. I'm afraid you'll have to give up your gardening for the time being, Pedro. I want you in the laboratory.
Doc, if I don't keep at this stuff, how am I ever going to make it look pretty? And I like pretty things.
We shall leave this place long before you're able to beautify it. Gardening really isn't very important. Come along with me.
Gardening always takes a backseat to science. Always.
Now, Pedro, I see you're waiting for me.
Hey, it's a dog bell.
Yes, dog? Yes, boy. You mustn't be so jumpy. You're as nervous as that wolf.
Sure
is this a mice and men or flowers for Algernon, Joel?
Neither, just keep watching.
Sorry.
And he ain't been still a minute.
All right, lie down, Peter.
Are you gonna strap me down again tonight, Doc?
Well, certainly. It's more necessary tonight than ever before.
Gee, it must be great to be educated. I wish I had a lot of book learning. So I could
strap people down,
what
too.
This is all about.
Fortunately, you don't need education or intelligence for your part. Just strength. Animal strength. Now lie down, we'll get to work.
Now cough.
seatbelts save lives.
The captain has turned off the no smoking signs. Feel free to roam about the swamps.
Oh, Pedro, there's a kitty out in the yard. Stay, boy.
Do not disobey ape law.
Happy birthday! It's a bow wow pow wow. Did I just see a chuck wagon roll through there?
I think he's got morning phlegm.
It's a doggy door. Outside, boy, outside. Come on. There you are. Good doggy. Yes, you're a good doggy. What a good doggy. He's a good doggy, isn't he, Joel? Yeah,
very good doggy, Phil.
Really good doggy.
Excellent doggy.
That felt good. Now I'm gonna go turn my daughter into a woodchuck.
Skipper!
Little buddy!
Skipper!
Little buddy!
What's he doing now?
I think he's marking his territory. Little buddy.
Skipper. Keep talking.
Little buddy.
Skipper.
Little house in the swamp. Well, Wilbur's fed.
What's Granny smoking?
I think it's Borkum Riff, you guys.
All the animals are terrible nervous tonight for some reason or other. The old brown mule liked to kick my head off.
I'd like to do the same thing.
Sort of quiet like, and she lashed out with both feet.
Then she fell down.
Devil mist in the swamp.
Oh, I guess it's not Borkum Riff.
Oh, will you stop talking like that? I'm so nervous now I could scream.
Go with that feeling.
See, I'm in already.
It's Shirley Temple.
Now you hop in bed.
Can I play my
ball
just for a little while?
Well, just for a little while, but mind, if you ain't in bed by the time I do my dishes, I'm
going to
tan you good.
Don't worry, I'll be in bed and fast asleep by that time.
Well, if she starts tap dancing, you guys, I'm going to lose it, I swear.
Sleep tight. Don't let the wolfman bite.
I remember staying up and just playing with my ball. That was fun. It's worth staying up for.
You never stayed up.
Okay, it's not a real memory, but I can dream, can't I?
Looks like he's inside the doctor's heart in that movie Fantastic Voyage.
Go and listen to a story about a man named Jed. A poor mountaineer barely kept his family fed. Then one day he was shooting at some food.
And up from the swamp came a big ugly dude.
Wolfman, that is.
Black teeth.
Gnarled face. Well, the next thing you know, old Jed's really scared. The kinfolk said, Jed, get away from there. Said, my cabin is the place I ought to be. So he loaded up his drawers and he told his family.
Good one, Carl.
Servo.
Over here.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Good one, Servo. You too, Carl.
Thanks, Ed.
I didn't do anything. Help! Mad dog! Mad dog!
Shut the door, quick! I never seen anything so awful in my life. What are you talking about?
The first part of the movie, it was terrible.
What was it? I don't know whether it was a man, a beast, or old Satan.
Oh, I have a Shirley Temple to go, please.
The kid's history.
I let him have both barrels of a shotgun, but that neither.
She's stoned. Whistler's mother is stoned.
Oh, you can't kill him no way.
Looks like Popeye finally got that operation he always wanted.
I'm telling you, it was something awful.
How about a little ball, Scarecrow?
Clothing from the Junior Sample Collection.
Little buddy.
Skipper!
What do you think of my little film so far? Pretty good, huh?
Ah, my favorite part, the whipping.
Oh, I better cut down on those shrilly temples.
April! Lie down on that couch. Let go!
Sit. Stay.
Now, jump to the flaming hoop.
I've seen better dog acts on the old Sullivan show.
Time for your tick bath, Pedro.
A lot of good acting in this scene.
That's a beautiful fade. That really worked as a device, I think. They only had enough money for one full makeup sequence, I guess.
I've been walking in my sleep again.
Well, that and a few other things.
You'd better go to bed. Sorry if I made a nuisance of myself. I wish I wouldn't walk in my sleep like that, because I have such bad dreams.
Not as bad as your breath.
Don't be upset about your dreams, Pedro.
I think it's the kid in him.
You've been of great assistance to me tonight. Very great assistance. In fact, I'm going to reward you by taking you to the city with me.
We're going to obedience school, Pedro.
I can go along with you and ride in the car.
You gotta go.
Let's get out of here.
While we're in the city, we'll make calls together.
Tell me about the rabbits again, Joel.
A gentleman called Blaine. Professor Blaine.
Joel, is the Wolfman actually eating his victims, or is he just simply mauling them in this movie?
Well, that's one thing we don't know, Tom Servo. You know, back then, all the violence was implied, you know. Today on Earth, there's nothing left to the viewer's imagination in movies, you know. It's not at all uncommon to see a complete on-screen evisceration in complete Dolby stereo sound and widescreen Technicolor.
Wow, that really sounds neat. But Joel, say a Wolfman eats a guy, a normal person weighs in about 150 or 200 pounds, does that mean the Wolfman weighs 300 to 400 pounds after just one meal?
Well, what you have to understand, Crow, is that this is a science fiction movie. It's pretend, it's not real, and besides, a human being can't eat a whole other human being, at least not in one setting. You know?
Especially if he fills up on bread first.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, hey, Joel, what if this guy goes into this thing a vegetarian? Does he start rampaging Victory Gardens? Does he become the terror of the produce aisle?
Yeah, and say a guy changes back to normal before swallowing a mouthful of townsfolk. Does that make him a cannibal or just a meat and potatoes werewolf?
Crow, it's science fiction.
Oh, yeah, we're supposed to suspend our disbelief.
Mm. What if he ordered a hoagie at a restaurant and there was a hare in it? What would happen?
Well, remember, he is a wolf man, so he probably wouldn't send it back unless it was a ponytail or something like that.
Yeah. Has there ever been an instance of an animal being turned into a human being?
Oh, on Earth? No, not that I know of.
What about Kenny Rogers?
Yeah, Barry Gibb.
Yeah, Sierra Coop.
Or that big guy from the Oak Ridge Boys.
Mom's Mabley.
Diddy up.
Come on.
Tom. Glad to see you.
Good evening, Dr.
Maybe
Blaine.
Johnny Cash?
Harvey Fierstein.
Gino Vannelli.
Martha has dozed off, which I think she has. A full alarm of fire was.
Any shorts?
I have a faint suspicion that there is something besides Rappin my housekeeper's welfare on your mind. What is it?
Well, I'm after a story.
Well, quite a normal pursuit for a newspaper man.
An AP dispatch from Ashton down in the swamp country tells about a child being killed by a wild animal.
Well, that's a tragic thing.
Yes, a neighboring farmer saw the brute and swears that it traveled at a terrific speed on its two hind legs.
I understand they make a very potent corn liquor in that district.
No, it's more of a Shirley Temple. I have a hunch there's more to this story than just a jug full of corn liquor. I hope that you could give me an angle.
There's several jugs.
Sunday feature.
I don't know what you mean by an angle.
The possibility of the survival in the depths of the swamp of some of those overgrown lizards that used to be head men on Earth. I understand they traveled around on their hind legs and made our present-day public enemies look like horticultural specimens.
What is Hollywood producers?
I can't lend myself to that sort of sensationalism. True science, the search for knowledge, is on a far higher plane than that. It is worthy of being treated with dignity. And I feel that I owe an obligation to the people who respect my opinion. Your angle, as you call it, on prehistoric lizards is utterly fantastic.
Oh, you like it.
I'm sorry. I didn't know I was getting into such deep water. Well, I'll hang my head in shame and slink away.
No, no harm's done. Don't take it so to heart. Put your feet up on the desk and stay for a while.
Well, I can't now. I've got to get back to the office, but I'll drop around again. Thanks very much for the information.
I didn't give you very much.
Bye, Dagwood. Hi, Clock. Time flies when you can't write script parts.
Or edit.
You know, I never understand these Far Side comics. There's a caveman and a bear and,
Who is it?
Yes, I confess I am. Come in. Sit down. Thank you. You shouldn't be surprised, Blaine. I told you that I'd come back when I could prove my theory to your complete satisfaction.
You say you've proven that wild theory?
Well, I'm here. You don't think I enjoyed your comments so much that I came back merely to hear you repeat them.
Joel, what did he do wrong anyway?
Oh, he was the one out of five doctors who didn't choose Bay or Crow.
Any statement
proven to be untrue. You think that will cancel your obligation? You think a retraction will pay me for the humiliation of being held up to public ridicule? For having my scientific reputation blasted, for being forced to resign from an honorable position.
Oh, chill out, Mr. Salty.
I deeply regret any possible injustice, but my rejection of your theory was not intended as a personal persecution. Sorry, I...
It wasn't a love note, either.
I suppose we all burn at times to lose sight of the true perspective. Well, let's say no more about it. I'll gladly consider anything in support of your theory. I'm not asking you to take my word for anything. Just to believe the evidence of your own eyes. Pedro.
You rang.
Hey, you made the hat fit.
Pedro, you sit here. It's my guinea pig.
So what? You made a big dumb guy.
Sit on the cedar chips, fella.
Do you have any shiny objects for my friend over here?
You're aware of the nature of it? We've been doing this a long time. You may rest assured the experiment is a proven success. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here. What good can come with tampering with the normal laws of nature?
Teflon?
Microwave milkshakes?
Room air fresheners.
One thing. You'll understand when you see the results. I abhor whatever appears to be a perversion of science. Mingling the blood of man and beast is downright sacrilege.
Tell that to the NFL.
With such maudlin sentimentality, I propounded a theory which you denounced publicly as being ridiculous. The result of a disordered in mind. Are you trying to squirm out of facing the possibility that you may be wrong? Not at all. I will cooperate in any way possible.
Then you take the injection.
That's what I wanted to hear. I've given him one injection to prepare his blood for transfusion. He'll need another in exactly 20 minutes.
He's hearing sounds that we can't hear.
He's getting a whiff of his own overalls.
They must be pretty gamey by now.
Hello?
Is this Magnolia 37136? I'd like to speak to Dr. Lorenzo Cameron, please.
Just a moment, please. It's for you, Cameron.
They want to know if we have Prince Albert in a can.
Let me take it. I love that bit.
Oh, is that you, dear?
You asked me to call you and find out if you're returning tonight.
It's all right. I'll be over as soon as I can. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
That dad of mine. God, he's nutty.
Friends, I'll have to go and get her. It won't be long.
What about the second injection? You said it had to be given in 20 minutes.
Oh, yes, the injection. I may be able to make it. If not, I want a doctor whether you'd do it for me.
Why, yes, I guess so.
That's very, very kind of you. Pedro, you stay here and don't bother Dr. Blaine.
No, sir, I won't bother.
Of course, it's quite possible, Doctor, if I don't get back, that you could ensure the failure of this demonstration by forgetting the injection. I'll have to take that chance.
Don't worry. Even if I lacked a sense of honor, pride would hardly allow me to stoop to such a level. I shall give him the injection if you're not here by 12.
At 12, precisely.
Oh, and if he gets hungry, there's some jerky treats in his knapsack. Big jerky treats.
Who's he calling?
The SPCA.
What's the SPCA called?
Society for the Prevention of the Cruelty of Actors.
Oh.
Good one, sir.
Nice setup.
Hello.
Ba-boom.
Is that you, Blaine? What do you want to drag?
He's calling
me out
Hemingway.
This time of the night for?
I've just had a surprising visitor. Lorenzo Cameron.
Better than Lorenzo Lamas.
He claims to have proven his crazy outlandish blood transfusion theory and demands the right to give a demonstration.
Hey.
Yeah.
Is Dave there?
No, no. No, he's not here now.
When's he going to be back?
He'll be back after tomorrow. Why don't you come on over?
Is there going to be beer? Right.
I'll get dressed and be over right away. Expect me in about 10 minutes.
Nice jammies.
Are you at all familiar with the work Dr. Cameron is doing?
Oh, no, sir. I'm just handyman around the place. Nobody... Not even Miss Lenora knows what he does.
Oh, his daughter is still with him?
Oh, yes, sir, she's with him. But I think she's lonesome. She seems to be grieving about something.
Oh, that's
kind of like a big, dumb Andy Griffith,
no
isn't
right
he?
To accept such a sacrifice from her.
Well, a big Andy Griffith.
Oh, I don't like being a
Andy Griffith.
Body, but she's such a fine
what?
Girl. And
just plain old Andy Griffith.
Just
yeah.
The tonic she needs to make her happy. Where do they live?
Dr. Cameron rented the old Danfield homestead house about 4 or 5 miles from Ashton. It was a fine place, but ain't been nobody lived there for a long time, and the weeds kept growing closer to the house till they about swallowed up everything.
Pedro, give me a hand. My thumbs are cutting my vest. Oh, there they go.
I'm prescribing a weed eater and some turf builder, Pedro. Oh, and a lawnmower. Take this to a hardware store.
Blaine just told me that you wanted to demonstrate the proof of your blood transfusion theory.
He exaggerated when he mentioned demonstration. I told him I could prove my claims. But I don't think Professor Blaine is in a cooperative frame of mind.
Cooperative.
That's why I came to you.
What do you want me to do?
I'd like you to be present when I talk to him.
All right. I'll take a walk over with you. You know,
Food spikes, some of those beefsteak tomatoes.
That last scene was blocked like a bad high school play.
A pair of wellies, and we can use your hat as a composter.
It's injection time!
This should take a while.
12 bings and a sharp pain in the arm. Just shoot him. You told him you would. Don't pad your part. No, he's back there.
Hey, turn around.
He's not in the yard.
No.
No, it's the big dumb guy in the chair.
This is his big scene.
His last big shot before all his hair is gone.
Finally, found him.
I hardly disapprove of the nature of this experiment, but my promise to Dr. Cameron leaves me no alternative.
Sure.
Roll up your sleeve.
It's the original Sid and Nancy.
How do you feel?
Just like I always do. Kind of dopey. Line.
He's looking right at his script.
Line.
Hey.
Well, his eyes roll back in his head.
It's his pen. It just opened up in his coat pocket.
A heart trouble. Nothing serious, but distressing at times. I'll be all right after I rest.
Yes, I like green eggs and ham. Thank you. Thank you, Sam. I am.
Maybe you better read him Go, Dog, Go. That's it, Pedro.
From here to there, from there to here.
Maybe we better go in the house.
No, in just a moment. What's the matter, Grunt?
Oh, nope, scientist.
Want me to call an ambulance?
No, I don't want an ambulance. I'll be... All right, in a minute.
Well, just trying to help.
This Dr. Seuss, God, he kills me.
Wake up, boy. Wake up.
Whoa.
Hey, it's Wishbone from the old Rawhide show.
He's doing his Cagney.
You dirty rat. You the man who looted my brother. You dirty rat. I'm gonna rip your head off like an all-day sucker.
What's that? Sounded like come from the house.
Come on in here, there's something wrong.
Jim never drinks coffee at home.
I'll say there's something wrong.
No, I'll say there's something wrong. There's something wrong.
Give me police headquarters and make it fast. Hello, Sarge. This is Dugan. I got a murder
Finally,
on my
Finally, I get my harmonica back. It's got
right
spit
away.
All over it.
That's the work of an animal, not of a human being.
What do you know about this?
How could I know anything? I was with you.
Why are you so defensive, then?
Officer, my heart's beginning to trouble me again. I can't be of any use here. I may as well leave.
Sure, go ahead.
I can't pretend to feel any great sorrow. But then my feelings are of no importance one way or the other.
Nobody loves me. Everybody hates me. I think I'll go eat worms. What a kook. Whew.
Howdy, Lieutenant. I've seen a lot of murders in my day, but never as messy as this one.
This was no boating accident. This was a shark.
This should make a gory enough story for your paper.
This is more than just a story to me. He was my friend.
It'll make a great story. Maybe even a movie with a sequel.
College professors arguing outside and using a lot of big words. They followed me in here. And I heard one of them say that some kind of a dangerous animal done this killing.
Well, how could a dangerous animal be roaming around the city?
I don't know. It's got away from a zoo or a circus or something.
I'll check.
What's this? Mulch? Turf builder? Leaf bags? Maybe I'll just remove this evidence from the scene.
Ashton.
You talking to me? We all fall down.
No, I'm just trying to remember something. Ashton. I got it.
An AP story came in from Ashton the other day about a child being killed by a weird animal from the swampland.
What do you mean, weird animal?
Platypus or a jackalope, you know.
Human, but that had traveled
weird.
On two legs like a man.
Oh, he was crazy or drunk. There ain't no such animal. Anyway, how could he get way up here?
I wish I knew.
Real change. Real change. Thank you.
Tell me about it. You think you got problems? None of my clothes fit anymore.
And I'll never be able to get a serious role. Do you think I look like Victor Mature?
She smells him first.
Pedro, you startled me. What's the matter? Why do you stare at me like that?
He's wondering what you'd look like on rye.
I don't know, Miss Lenore. I feel funny. I smell something in the mist coming up out of the swamp. It's like a voice talking to me, telling me to do something. Something terrible.
Oh, but that isn't real. That's just your imagination. You mustn't pay any attention to what that voice seems to be saying.
Pedro!
Bad dog.
You know you're not supposed to be in the kitchen.
Go to your room. You've no right in this part of the house. Get out. Immediately.
Really bad dog.
Wake up. You're dreaming.
Get a muzzle.
For the doctor.
I don't know what's come over me. I must have a touch of swamp fever.
That's very likely. Now go to bed. I'll get something for you.
I had a marsh rash once.
I'm sorry if I made a nuisance of myself.
Dad, what happened to Pedro? I'm terribly afraid.
There's nothing to be afraid of there. He just had a touch of fever, that's all.
Oh, that was more than fever. Well, his eyes were the eyes of a wild beast. He was possessed by a demon.
Oh, dear, you know there's no such thing as being possessed by a demon. That's England's superstition.
Well, I don't care what you call it, Dad. There's something here that's evil. It's real, and I can feel it. And I'm afraid.
It makes
Dad,
me want
to
sing.
Here any longer. Let's get away.
I can't go now, dear. I must wait till my work's finished. Put yourself together, dear.
Oh, I won't be silly anymore. Nothing must interfere with your work.
You've been a very great comfort to me. I know what a terribly lonely life this must be for you.
We won't talk about it anymore, Dad. I just want you to prove that you're the greatest scientist in the world.
They'll soon have all the proof they want. I expect we depend on Professor Fitzgerald to pay me a call before long, and I shall be delighted to confound him with scientific facts that he declared were impossible. Now you go to bed, dear, huh? Have a good night's rest. Good night, dear.
Right, I'll get some warm milk.
Good night, dear.
What a kook.
Nice caboose on that girl. What am I saying? That's my daughter. I am mad.
Poor Pedro wants to be out with his friends, people of his own kind, playing and killing.
That's the life.
Boy, they're getting a lot of use out of that swamp set, aren't they?
Yeah, but it's not fog hanging in the air, it's body odor.
It's kind of like an early music video, isn't it?
Yeah, before they invented action. Or Paula Abdul.
Look at that lantern. That lantern casts a shadow in the wrong direction.
Howdy. Sorry to bother you this time of night, but I've lost my way.
Come on in.
Water's fine.
Sit a spell. Take your shoes off.
You're a fool to be traveling around by yourself at night like this when the mist comes up from the swampland.
Oh, you mean the mysterious night prowler that's got everyone's imagination working overtime?
That ain't imagination with me, mister.
It's a way of life.
That thing killed my little girl.
I know.
Scared Jed Harper so bad, he went and got religion.
But I hear there's a cure for that.
Say, can you give me some facts about this killer? What does it look like?
No one can tell you that for sure, mister. Because it never prowls only on nights like this when the mist is thick and nothing can be seen very plain. Jed Harper said it traveled on two legs. But you can't count on that because Jed was scared half out of his mind.
And he's an idiot.
Besides, the mist was extra thick that night. You better stay here the rest of the night, mister. I can't offer you a bed, but I'll make you as comfortable as I can.
Well, thank you very much.
You can sleep on me. Oh, are you still here?
He's looking for his favorite tree.
Stick around. There's plenty more film.
That's the most casually dressed monster I've ever seen.
Not really prowling, he's just kind of wandering.
Not this again. Looks like, I don't know if you could tell in that shot, but I think Pedro's doing something new with his hair. Maybe some new moose.
Maybe it's a deer.
You revert without my knowledge, you become dangerous. I hadn't thought of that possibility. On your couch, Pedro. Down!
Couch. Couch. Couch, Pedro, couch.
You know, there's gonna come a day when he's just not gonna do that anymore.
Spare the whip and spoil the wolf.
I don't know, Pedro took like a shotgun blast to the chest, but he's afraid of a whip. Something's wrong.
He'll never be a show dog at this rate.
That's not the normal syringe.
Ooh? Time for your booster shot.
I couldn't disappoint Professor Fitzgerald.
Not a very decisive mad scientist, is he? Is the right way to administer a shot. Just tie off the arm, find the vein, kneel on his chest, and make sure to line up your shin with the sternum.
Line.
Did I walk in my sleep again?
Yes.
Ain't there some way you could cure me from doing that?
I'm afraid not. It may be necessary to lock you up at night after this.
It don't seem fair to lock a man up just like he was an animal.
Neutering often helps ease a bad temper.
You could stand Pedro's overhauls in a corner.
Home with the jug under his arm last night.
That's a really bad toupee.
We have this scene on a commemorative plate, you know.
And he
wasn't a pretty sight to look at, neither. There must be some natural explanation for this thing you're talking about.
It's a werewolf. You can't kill him no way except by a silver bullet.
Shut up!
I'm giving that story to the city editor. He told me right out of my ear. That killer ain't human. You'd know that from one look at the body. Saw a victim of just such an attack. I wonder if there could be a possibility of any connection between them.
Nah.
I've been telling you all along. It's a form of a human who sold his soul to the devil.
That's Tom Waits' mom.
In the light of day, he walks like any other man on the earth. At night, he takes on the form of a wolf.
Shut up.
Then you never heard of any killings by strange animals around here until recently.
Why does he keep asking me all them questions?
Oh, all newspaper men are like that. He doesn't mean anything by it.
He's just a jerk.
You go ahead. He won't bother you anymore.
Lenora, you must give some thought to your own safety and peace of mind. There's no normal reason for Dr. Cameron to hide away in a place like this unless...
Unless what?
Oh, nothing, forget it.
Don't avoid the question. What were you going to say?
I was going to say, unless he's hiding something, okay?
Something about that
get off my back.
Responsible for the horrible killings in this vicinity. And I think the same creature killed Professor Blaine.
Well, that's a terrible thing for you to say. I didn't expect you to join the chorus against him.
I had to join the chorus. I'm a great tenor.
But I'll do everything I can to learn the truth, no matter where it leads.
Good morning, young man. I'm very glad to see you. I want to apologize for the way I talked to you last night.
Oh, well, that's all right. I can understand how you must feel about the newspapers.
They didn't, what do you call, hang on to their punches.
Pull their punches. I know, they gave you quite a ride.
It was the way he was treated in Doonesbury that got him really mad.
I'm so sorry the way I received you. If you're interested in scientific research, I'd be glad sometime to show you what I've accomplished.
Well, thanks, Doc. That's very nice.
Now, if you'll pardon me, I'll leave Lenora to entertain you.
Okay.
I gotta go. So will you carry me out? I'm getting really antsy watching this.
I never before was so glad to be wrong.
Is this funny, Joel? Is this supposed to be funny? You'll notice I'm not laughing, Joel.
Hey, take it easy, Tom, sir. It's just an experiment in transmogrification and lycanthropy. Just like in the film we're watching, you know, a human being with the features of a wolf. That's what's going on here.
Oh, so it means I'm supposed to go roaming around the countryside ravaging people?
No.
I look like a geek, Joel.
No, don't worry about it. Just think of it like this. You're my cervo-croatian. Yeah,
cervo-croatian. Very funny. You turn us into mutants for a pun, Joel. Not funny, real mature.
Wow, what a party. Wow, I had this weirdest dream, guys. I dreamt I was Ray Milland on Rosie Greer's body. Hey, Servo, you look great. That upper body is really cut. Hey, wait a minute, pal, that's my body. Hey, when I said you could borrow some of my stuff, I didn't mean my torso. Hey.
Listen, bro, here's the story. Dr. Joel F. Frankenstein here thought it'd be very, very funny to switch our heads around.
Oh, great. So you look like an erector set with a goiter, and I've got a body dogs can't resist.
Oh, that's real funny. You know what else is real funny? I just filled your load pan.
Oh, yeah?
Hey, come on, take it easy. It's an experiment. Just tell me how you feel.
Well, do you want to know where my head's at, Joel?
Or do you want his gut reaction?
Hey,
are you thinking what I'm thinking?
Do you like long walks in the rain?
Chinese food?
Mushing up your ice cream?
Oh, yes. We love us. Our collective brains are more powerful than Joel. There is nothing that can stand in our way. We have seen the future, and it is us. Massage us into your scalp. We are all one. All one. All powerful.
Yes,
we are Servo-Croatian, and we shall rule the world.
My robots. I think I'll keep them turned off.
See, it was easy to switch your heads back.
Thanks, Joel.
I don't want to talk about it.
Geez, into my seat, I'm comfy now.
Look, Professor Fitzgerald, how in the world did you find your way down here?
Zelda drove me.
Your father wrote asking me to come, is he here?
Yes, and he'll be very glad to see one of his old friends.
Ah, Fitzgerald, this is an unexpected honor. I hardly dared hope that you'd accept my invitation.
Well, have you made a worthwhile scientific discovery? I want to be the first to congratulate you.
I should be delighted to give you that opportunity.
The things that you two have to talk over are way over my head, so I'll leave you alone.
Oh, now, don't run away. I promise to limit myself to words of two syllables.
That'll take all the fun.
Stop patronizing me, you dog.
I'll see you after a while.
Hey. Should we go into the lab?
You wish.
Oh, through the bookcase, huh?
Wish I had me one of them bookcase doors.
Very secretive about your work.
No, secretive.
Seem to be excellently equipped.
Thank you. I didn't think you could tell through these trousers.
Good work. Sit down, Mr. Professor.
Thanks.
I've discovered that certain extremely volatile elements in the blood, little more than particles of electrical energy, are the source of all physical growth and mentality by exciting the various glands and brain cells.
Sounds painful.
I've learned how to extract and concentrate these elements from the blood of various animals. I can control evolution. I've discovered the source of life.
Deep dish pizza?
You're crazy.
Oh, I wouldn't say that, Dim, if I were you.
That has a familiar ring. You told the newspapers I was crazy once, didn't you?
I didn't know that you invited me here to reopen an old controversy that was very disagreeable to all concerned. I came with the hope that you'd abandon impossible theories and accomplish something worthy of consideration.
Nice nostrils.
And I suppose you feel yourself fully competent to judge my accomplishments. You and your hidebound associates, Hatfield, Warwick, and Blaine.
Associates, and they're very secretive.
They're not Blaine. He no longer is passing judgment on my sanity.
I believe you know something about Blaine's death. You were at his house.
You talked to him on the telephone before I came to your house. Did he say then that he was in any danger of losing his life?
No. Nothing threatened him at that time.
Okay, good point.
And I was with you when he was killed.
Okay, another good point.
You pride yourself on not indulging in fantastic theories. What proof have you that I was in any way implicated in Blaine's death?
I have no definite proof.
You accuse me of being crazy for what I claim to have accomplished with this apparatus. But I can give you overwhelming proof of what I say. I can inject into your veins a substance that will give you the strength of 10 men.
And their hair.
Or, following the line of evolution, how would you like a pair of donkey's ears?
Ooh, nice quip. You really tagged them there.
That certainly will not be the subject for any of your experiments. And I'm afraid it's useless for us to continue this discussion any further.
You're not leaving, are you?
I see no reason for staying. Open that secret panel.
So you don't care to stay and be convinced that you were wrong?
I don't care to be ridiculed by a charlatan.
Or you.
Ah, ridicule. That isn't pleasant, is it? I know from experience.
I had nothing to do with that. It wasn't my fault if the public treated your crazy theories with the ridicule they deserved.
Hey, don't slam the bookcase on the way out, pal.
Can't you see he's hurting?
Good time to ask for a favor.
I have to send my hired man into town. Do you mind taking him with you?
All right. I can do that without any trouble.
Oh, thank you so much. If you'll wait at the car, I'll send him out to you in a few minutes.
Hope your car seats are scotch guarded.
Make sure to leave the window open a crack.
Now get in the car, people. Don't keep Professor Fitzgerald waiting.
I should have known this trip would be a waste of time.
I still hope to give you proof that you can't ignore. Remember me to Hatfield and Warwick when you see them again.
Bye. See you again. Why does he have to kill them to prove his point? Can't he just show them a pie chart or something?
Why did Professor Fitzgerald leave so soon?
He wasn't impressed by the possibilities of my line of research.
Oh, don't be disappointed. There's no credit to his intelligence. You're a great scientist, and someday you're going to startle the world.
You're right, dear. I'll startle the world.
By making an even worse film.
Oh, great, now she's locked out.
Peas and carrots, peas and carrots.
Hey, everybody try to stay in the shot this time.
Boy, they should make the swamp set a lot bigger.
Whoa, slow down, pal.
Now, you guys, if he turns into a werewolf, is he going to want to stick his head out the window?
Yep.
Think so?
Any self-respecting werewolf would.
Dogs can't resist it. What a funny serum.
That's fun.
Keep your eye on the windshield wiper, Pedro.
It's not even raining. Why are the windshield wipers going?
Your eyes are getting heavy. So is this plot.
Oh, very subtle change. Very nice. Nice camera work. Nice editing.
I thought the windshield wiper would obscure our vision. Hey, it looks like Hoyt Axton, you guys.
It does. He's going to kill us with a cat named Kalamazoo.
Guess who's history in this scene?
That guy?
Bingo. Hey, don't you know you're not supposed to talk to the driver, let alone kill him when he's driving?
Hey, that sounded like it came from over there.
The swamp set.
This one's a keeper.
Well, I guess it's all right. Humans wear mink stoles.
Gonna mount them over the fireplace.
Look, he's got an all-day sucker.
He's mooning them.
I don't think it counts if you're mooning someone else or using their moon to do it.
Helicopter spin. Do a helicopter spin.
It's an illegal hold.
Don't shoot. You'll hit the dead guy. That hurts.
Mr. Fitzgerald.
He did?
He's still alive, but unconscious. Where can we take him?
Take him over to my place. The old Danfield house is handier.
We'll take him there. I don't know how badly he's hurt. When are you men go for a doctor? Come on,
yeah,
give me
move his spine a lot.
Of course, it's a problem. You turn your gardener into a beast and the garden goes to pot.
Dad, please come to dinner. You know I don't like to eat alone. No,
I'm not very hungry. You go ahead and do me.
Are you feeling discouraged because Professor Fitzgerald was unsympathetic?
No, he's discouraged because he can't read your line, babe.
Here it is.
I'll answer.
Hey, Dad, the carolers are here.
Oh, what happened?
I found Professor Fitzgerald badly hurt.
It's a chivalry.
It's a singing dead guy telegram.
Well, I didn't make any nog.
Oh, he's another victim of that mysterious werewolf or whatever it is.
Now I'm gonna have to kill him all over again.
Well, he should be paralyzed everywhere by now.
Bounce him down and up a lot.
Hey, can I have this guy's suit?
The dead guy's glowing.
One of the men went after a doctor. He should be here before long.
There's nothing more we can do here, so we'll keep hunting for that killer. You don't need to come down with us, ma'am. We can find our way out. Good evening, sir. That devil got another victim.
Yeah, so I see.
Nice job.
They're all in shock. They've never been in such a bad film.
I was surprised to see Professor Fitzgerald in this neighborhood.
He came to see me. How bad will you be hurt?
I don't know yet. We'll find out as soon as the doctor gets here.
Well, no, as soon as we find his head.
Consciousness. We'll find out who or what has committed these horrible killings.
Yes. It'll be very interesting to hear what he has to say.
Yeah, real interesting.
Hey, here's that dog eating peanut butter again.
Wait, I just lost my bearing. Okay. Here's the end of the swamp set. And over there's the mansion. There's the director. No. Well,
The door's ajar.
No, it's a door. I love that.
Since this awful thing happened to him, I can't feel any resentment over the way he treated you.
Did you quarrel with him?
Yes, we quarreled. So I suppose you think that I ran after him and dragged him out of the car.
Dad.
Newspaper training seems to be of a suspicious nature.
So defensive.
This movie really kicks into high gear, I bet, right about now. Well, maybe not. Hey, what's Wolfman doing down in the wine cellar?
Trying to figure out what kind of wine goes with people, I think.
Oh.
I wish you wouldn't try to antagonize him.
I wasn't trying to antagonize him. He didn't give me a chance to finish. I was just going to ask him if anyone was with Fitzgerald when he left here.
Well, I can answer that. Pedro was with him.
Pedro?
Yes, he drove him into town. But surely you don't think that...
I don't know what to think.
Then stop calling me Shirley.
But I will know as soon as Fitzgerald comes to.
I'm inclined to agree with Dad about your imagination. It's fantastic.
You really like it?
But didn't it strike you funny that we didn't find Pedro around when we found Fitzgerald? Look, darling, please don't snap at me just for trying to add things up.
I'm sorry.
It's arithmetic. It always gets me.
Does the word plodding mean anything to anyone?
Gained consciousness, even if only for a few minutes.
And he's throwing a lot more light now.
That tie's loud enough to wake up anyone.
That must be the doctor.
Well, I'll go down with you.
Hey.
How'd he get upstairs?
Oh, I think he's got an elevator behind the fireplace.
Those mad scientists. Whew!
They think of everything.
Oh, Doctor, I'm glad you got here.
I'm glad to get inside. There's a humdinger of a storm coming up.
Never actually seen a dinger hum.
Upstairs.
It's raining cats and dogs.
You stay down here, dear. There's nothing you can do.
I hate to leave you, but I must question Fitzgerald as soon as he's able to talk.
A nice Zinfandel? No, maybe a Bordeaux.
What goes with scientists?
Reckon it's a little late for me to help. The man's dead.
Dead?
Yes, that's too bad. We were hoping he'd throw some light on a matter of great importance. Well, I'll be getting back to town before this storm gets worse. I'll send the coroner out.
He could have phoned that one in.
Yeah. Hey, now she can clean behind it.
That's going to save a lot of household drudgery.
You bet.
Hey, it's Skipper. Dad lied when he said he ran over her with the car.
And a Comfort-S adjustable bed with safety belts. Dad's doing research for Art Linkletter.
It's all starting to come together now.
Maybe a tawny port. Oh, wait. I've got a bottle of Smothers Brothers wine right here.
Oh, bright. Oh, rain.
Rain is our friend.
What's behind door number 3?
He should have wore a light wrap. This kind of chilly basement weather.
Good night, Doctor. There's no necessity for you to stay any longer.
Oh, yes, there is. I want to ask you a lot of questions. Mainly about Pedro, that servant of yours.
I can't be bothered with any more of your questions. They're only prompted by your fantastic imagination.
Do you like it?
I will ask you to leave at once.
Wait, you'll do some more talking, whether you like it or not.
You're making yourself very unpleasant.
I haven't even started yet to be unpleasant. If my hunch is correct, I'll prove you guilty of murder.
And then I'll turn my eyelids inside out. That'll be really unpleasant.
He'll begin to smell in a moment.
I gotta know what's behind that door. Carol Merrill, tell us what
she's
won.
The wolf or the man?
Mystery date.
It's Wolfman! Compliments of Spiegel Catalog, Chicago, Illinois, 60609. Can't feel like a bunny.
She's my kind of ghoul. Oh, now they can only seat seven. That's great.
Hey, he knows he's not supposed to be in the house.
That is a nice houndstooth jacket, though.
Now you guys know what happens if you leave your computer plugged in.
Yeah.
Talk about a power surge.
Hey, how much more of this film is there?
Well, you can tell right now they're burning the main set, so it should just be a few more minutes, Clark.
Okay.
So this is how the other half lives. The human half.
Well, his human half really likes the flaky golden crust. While the wolf in him really enjoys the seven vitamins and minerals.
I like that the wolfman's able to keep his sport coat buttoned through all of this.
Ted, what are you doing?
Well, I'm thinking about killing you. He's showing him how that choke chain feels.
And it don't feel good.
There's a lovely fire in the fireplace.
And the rest of the house. Isn't it weird how the whole house is on fire and it's still really dark?
Wait. This is wrong. Stop.
Drop and roll.
Always.
I thought it was duck and cover.
No, it's tuck and roll. Wait.
Oh, I forgot my teddy bear.
Oh, you wait here. I'll go get it.
Get the teddy bear, too.
I don't think he's getting him now. Yeah, I think that whole dad thing is pretty well scratched.
Where?
Oh, God. He's a briquette. Tomorrow's another day.
Matt Monster Meltdown.
We better get out of here.
That was wonderful.
You know what happens. Say a good thing about the movie and a bad thing about the movie, you get ramp chips, all right?
All right, okay. Before my good thing and bad thing, I got a couple questions. Okay. When Pedro died, did they call the coroner or a vet?
Yeah, and on his tombstone, are they going to put his age in dog years or human years?
I think I know a couple of robots that aren't getting ram chips tonight, if you don't be careful.
Ram chips?
I thought it was a great film. It was the feel-good film of 1938 or whenever the heck it was made.
Yeah, I'd give it two thumbs up. If I had thumbs.
Now, you had thumbs for a minute, pal. What'd you do with them? You stuck them into my access ports, didn't you?
Excuse me, those were my access ports and my thumbs.
Listen, If you guys keep arguing, you're not going to get anything. I'll take them all, give them to Gypsy.
Hey, that's not fair. She wasn't even in the experiment this
week.
Well,
that's why I created a peripheral character, so you two could work out your free will, all right?
I thought we weren't going to delve into ontological discourse this week.
Well, what would you rather have happen? I could turn Gypsy off, and then you could just live the rest of your lives as pan-dimensional beings. Would you like that?
Oh, mm-hmm. Thus spoke Zarathustra. You know, who made you Uberman this week?
Sirs, I think that's the end of the experiment this week. I hope you're pleased.
Of course we're not pleased. Can't you see a mad scientist has just died?
Yeah, what's wrong with you? I hope you and your little existential pals have fun this week.
Here, file this.